It was a long shot, getting into the world's most secretive state. The diplomatic door between New Zealand and North Korea has been closed for years. But slipping in and out, a small team of Kiwis using conservation as a common language. Sunday was granted exclusive access to join them. Here's Mark Kreisel.
Across the Yalu River, on a slow train from Dandong, China.
The challenge is to get all the customs done before we get across the bridge.
The Chinese call it the Friendship Bridge, one of the few ways to get in or out of North Korea.
Rice.
Handbag.
European. Rice.
But it's hard to think we're going anywhere friendly.
No weapons. Poisons. No.
With threats of nuclear war, human rights abuses, abductions and executions, North Korea has been called the world's most dangerous rogue state.
So if something happened to us when we were in there, what could you do?
Very little.
Entry is very strictly controlled by the North Korean regime, but a select few get extraordinary access.
So New Zealand has no diplomatic relations with North Korea?
No, not directly.
Essentially, no. Adrian, you're it.
Well, I don't know about that.
New Zealanders are very friendly. You are willing to teach us what you know.
He's no shiny suit. Adrian Regan is a chippy from West Auckland. But once a year, he downs tools and leads a team into sensitive parts of the world's most secretive state to count shorebirds.
These birds know no boundaries. They don't know anything about politics. They stop there because that's where they can find food.
The most famous of the shorebirds is the bar-tailed godwit, or kuaka. Every year, tens of thousands fly all the way from Alaska to New Zealand to feed in estuaries like Miranda in the Firth of Thames.
They're desperate to get that last little bit of food.
Here they're watched over by the Pokorokoro Miranda Naturalist Trust.
Most of those of you who've read the Miranda News will know that we have been involved with North Korea, or as they like to be called, the DPRK.
It's from these good, keen men and women that Adrian picks his team to go to North Korea.
Virtually everything has been rebuilt.
This year, he's taking Keith Woodley.
And it's turned out particularly well.
Artist.
Terrific detail.
And the Miranda Shorebird Centre manager.
The more you look at these shorebirds, the more amazing they turn out to be. And so you're just getting enthralled.
And David Melville, retired from Nelson, world-renowned as a shorebird ecologist.
We're not there for a luxury holiday, we're there to count birds.
Bearded, bespectacled, with birds on the brain. Are you bird watchers?
Try again.
Twitchers?
Again?
Bird fanciers? Birders. Ah!
Finally.
That's acceptable.
Finally you get it right.
What's undisputed is their dogged devotion to conservation.
The shorebirds in the world are the most threatened group of birds other than albatrosses.
Their global habitats are under serious threat.
Huge areas of mudflat have either disappeared or in the process of disappearing in just in the last, within a year. You know, if you're following a passion for these birds and you're concerned about their welfare, then it can be really, really disheartening to see.
The godwit's journey is nothing short of heroic, leaving the Arctic to fly all the way here for summer. It's the longest non-stop migration of any bird.
11,500 kilometres, 8-9 days, nights, continuous flying. Theoretically, it should be impossible for a bird to do that.
OK, 3, 2, 1, fire.
You'd think they'd get a rest in New Zealand.
That'll do. Yeah, take that away.
At the Foxton Estuary, a group of godwits have been netted, and Adrian's helping to band them so they can be identified as they move around the globe.
Wow. I can feel his heart.
Yeah, the hearts go fairly
quickly. Like a million miles an hour.
Yeah.
It's incredible to think this tiny thing takes such a huge, huge journey.
Non-stop from Alaska to Foxton, that bird.
The godwit is something of a long-distance lover, After summer in New Zealand, they abandon us.
No, it's good.
She's off.
She's feisty, that one. And there she goes.
Their destination is back to Alaska to breed, on a route known as the Flyway. The first leg is 6,000 kilometres to the Yellow Sea. The shorebirds arrive exhausted and hungry. They've lost more than half their body weight. If they don't eat, they won't survive the rest of the trip. But China and South Korea's massive economic growth has gobbled up much of their habitat.
The mudflats remaining have been modified through pollution and various other stresses and so forth. So for those sort of reasons, the habitat has been contracting. And so the populations of shorebirds depending on the Yellow Sea have all been declining as a result.
The Miranda team have been coming to one of the main feeding sites, the Yalujiang Nature Reserve in China, since the early 2000s. Every year they were counting fewer and fewer shorebirds. They looked across the river and wondered.
This could be the safety valve. This could be the place where these birds may find a refuge on their migrations.
Somebody needs to try and find a way to go and count the birds in along that coastline. So then it was a case of, how do we get into North Korea?
Foreign Minister Winston Peters is about to leave on an historic anti-nuclear mission to the reclusive state of North Korea.
So our ears pricked up at this. We said, let's write to Winston.
Dear Winston, when you're talking to the North Koreans, maybe you would like to mention these migratory shorebirds that we would love to go and investigate.
I thought, this is going to be a bit difficult to do.
So off went Winston Peters to Pyongyang to ask the North Koreans if a bunch of birders could poke around some of the most sensitive parts of their country.
Well, I did the best I could, and they put on a dinner one night. It was one of the most amusing dinners I've had for a long time. And we're sort of arm in arm walking out of the place at the end of the night. We felt we made some serious progress, so to speak.
How did you get to the point where you're arm in arm?
I won't describe that. It's the kind of thing that you don't want to be describing.
Whatever Winston Peters did on that late Pyongyang night, it worked.
Several months later, we get a call from the Ministry of Foreign Affairs to say Winston did ask, and the North Koreans said yes.
Now they had to go. When we come back, inside the Hermit Kingdom.
Are we allowed to film this?
It still blows me away.
It's late summer, and the Godwits are leaving New Zealand for the Yellow Sea.
We'll do all the things we do in a whole week. We'll go to sleep and we'll eat and we'll work and recreate. All they'll have done in that entire time is flap their wings and head north.
We're not far behind, except we're going by plane and train. China, then.
We're over.
We cross into the North Korean border town of Sinuiju.
You don't go into North Korea saying, oh, well, I'm just going to go and do what I want. Clearly, you respect the fact that you're very, very privileged to be invited to go there in the first place, and you behave accordingly.
We've arrived on the birthday of great leader, Comrade Kim Il-sung, North Korea's founder and still president despite dying in 1994. This is the sixth visit by the Miranda team. What's different this time is us. Foreign journalists are rarely let into North Korea.
When I approached them about it, thinking the answer would be immediately, there's no chance, they said that they were very excited and said this would be a good idea.
But a word of caution.
You'd better introduce or present to the world what you have seen and heard here like it is. There should never be cases in which you defame our country or slander our supreme dignity.
When Ri Song-il says supreme dignity, he's referring to North Korea's current leader, Kim Jong-un. Mr. Ri is the acting director of the Nature Conservation Union of Korea, similar to our Department of Conservation.
The first day tomorrow, the high tide time is 10:10, so we leave here at 7.
We're here at their invitation.
Mr. Ri, what might we be able to film here for television?
It's up to you.
Ah, so we can film what we like when we're down?
Yeah, but from here, within the inside the city, inside town, you don't take.
Nothing inside the city?
In the field, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. Okay. Yeah. Can we film the town from further back?
No. Forget.
Is it possible to tell us why that is?
No. Don't ask me.
North Korea is a very poor country, which doesn't always fit the image they want the world to see.
We see people who appear to be quite healthy and by no means starving is one of the misconceptions. Now, they have gone through some dreadful famine, so there were some really, really hard times that they're probably still recovering from. I've been thinking about this a lot. Because we want to go to the coastline to see shorebirds, they're random sites. And so for us to go there, we have to go pass through countryside. And I don't think there's any hint that we are taking on certain routes to avoid certain places, not to see this or not to see that.
We're joined on the journey by an entourage, young North Korean scientists and conservation staff.
So what were all the other goals then? Mm.
Mr. Park and Mr. Kim from North Korea's state film unit. And a whole lot of other guys in suits that we have no idea of what they do.
Do you think everybody in our delegation was who they said they were? You never know. You never know for sure. You know, you never know what role they play. They're just here. I just see them all as minders. And regardless of where they're from, they're minders and they're part of the landscape.
So while we're watching the Miranda team watch the birds, we're also being watched. The shorebird surveys take place in highly sensitive parts of the North Korean coast, the borders of a country that has felt under siege since the end of the Korean War.
We made the ceasefire treaty on 27th July 1953. Technically, we are still in the war.
We're forbidden from filming anything military, like border fences or soldiers, but despite the political complexities...
I have to think carefully how to say.
No, you don't have to think at all. You just say New Zealand birds.
What have we got?
The Miranda team and the North Koreans have formed a remarkable working relationship.
How many species? Shorebird.
Over shorebirds.
They're not New Zealand birds or Korean birds or Alaskan birds. They are just, you know, they belong to all of us, if you like. And that's the big thing. We want to encourage other people to care for them.
Our great Supreme Leader, Comrade Kim Jong-un, paid a lot of attention to conserve the biodiversity in our country. He gave us several instructions to strengthen the collaboration with other countries and international organizations.
The infrastructure is rickety. Just getting from A to B can be complicated. Checkpoints, picking up officials, none of it which we can show. This is a very sensitive area. There are lots of guardhouses, lots of soldiers. But the North Koreans have a way of making things happen when it appears all is lost. We're in the middle of a vast reed bed, heading for the coast. We're still not even at the sea. God knows where that is. I've lost the birders. It's a sticky slog through thick reeds, mud, creeks. But eventually,
found them.
We catch up with the Miranda team. They're maroon.
This is as far as we can go?
No, this is as far as we go at the moment.
Trying to find a boat?
Yeah.
Okay. Don't film over there. There are a bunch of guys in green uniforms trying to work out a way for us to go a little bit further.
The soldiers commandeer a passing fishing boat.
So, stop filming from about here.
And we're underway again.
You're a long way from West Auckland, mate.
Aren't we? Yeah. Yeah. Couldn't get much further, really, could we, in terms of habitat and distance. Yeah, it's quite extraordinary.
We make our way towards the sea, the unexpected guests of fishermen conditioned to see Westerners as the enemy.
OK, we've got some curlew on the bank over here.
Far eastern curlews are nesting in these massive reed beds. No godwits, but David Melville, the ecologist, could not be more excited.
This sort of reed bed was probably very common around much of the Yellow Sea coast in the past. But in China, there's nothing like this left now. It's all been reclaimed. So coming out here today and seeing this sort of habitat is just fascinating as an indication as to what it used to be like for thousands of kilometers, and it's all now gone.
Ironically, years of sanctions and North Korea's strict command economy have turned out to be a godsend for the shorebirds.
They're losing sites in South Korea and China, and they are able to find food in North Korea, then keeping those sites becomes vital.
Coming up, going where no foreigner has set foot. This is how the world sees North Korea. A totalitarian state inflicting famines on a brainwashed population. And massive military parades in Pyongyang's Kim Il-sung Square.
I have been several times since when I was 5 years old. In 1975, for the first time, I had the privilege to pass through here just to respond replying to great leader Comrade Kim Il-sung.
Wow.
Ri Song-il leads the Nature Conservation Union of Korea. He says North Koreans are required to protect the environment.
The great leaders and the dear supreme leader, Comrade Kim Jong-un, gave us a lot of instruction to conserve nature and the environment.
But it wasn't until the Miranda team turned up that they understood how important their coastline was to migrating shorebirds like the godwit.
If there's not many birds here, then...
The trick is to find them.
Maybe you can ask and see.
The aim of this entire trip is to get to Sindo Island. It's where they saw huge flocks of godwits all those years ago across the Yalu River from China.
There appears to be a lot of habitat over there which doesn't seem to have been as badly affected by development. It could be that we find a lot of birds.
So are the godwits fleeing the pollution for the safe, clean haven of Sindo? Finding out isn't easy. The island is a highly militarized border region, off limits to foreigners.
Among the foreign visitors, there are some evildoers, so the government cannot help but take some appropriate measures to prevent these activities.
We're not allowed to leave our hotels while we wait.
That's the toughest part, I think, of being here is, you know, it's not having the freedom to wander wherever we like, which, you know, we can at home.
Time is filled, looking out the window, people on bikes. Loudspeakers urging them to work hard or watching TV.
And there's one channel, and this is the news.
Images of the ruling Kim family dominate the landscape. Huge portraits and massive statues of the great leader Kim Il-sung and his son, dear leader Kim Jong-il.
We consider the great leaders as our own father of the family. We don't think they are passed away. We consider they will always be with us and we are implementing their instructions.
It's cult-like and state-controlled, but on a rare supervised walk, we get to see another side of life in North Korea. A water park. Traditional dancing. Young girls bring us flowers. Real or a setup? It's impossible to know.
The Supreme Leader, Kim Jong-un, does he know that we are here and is he happy for New Zealanders to be here?
Probably he might know.
Well, someone very high up in the North Korean government has signed off our access to Sindo Island.
Is this El Dorado for you?
Maybe it is.
The only way there is by boat. Supplies and entourage in tow, we board. The economic might of China on one side, rural North Korea on the other. It's a 3-hour trip to Sindo Island down the Yalu River.
We hope this will be a major piece of the puzzle sorted out for this area in terms of shorebirds and how they use it.
Arriving is tricky. There's no wharf, so we make land via another moored boat. New Zealanders and North Koreans. It's all hands on and off deck as we unload supplies and luggage. Accommodation is the island's only hotel. Power can be intermittent in North Korea. It's an early night for an early start. Anticipation for the birders is high.
I want to find lots of birds today, yeah.
Adrian's been trying to get here since he first looked across the river from China 18 years ago.
And the visibility is pretty good this morning.
Behind us are military checkpoints and a high security fence, but our focus is very much towards the coast.
This is a huge mud plant we've got in front of us, just massive.
It's low tide. The smokestacks of China feel close enough to touch. Adrian spots something.
They're just sort of tucked around the corner, so we'll go and have a look. Excellent.
Through the rushes. We can hear them before we see them.
Shh. Korea's being invaded.
The incoming tide is driving massive flocks of bar-tailed godwits towards the shoreline. For the birders, it's a David Attenborough moment.
Looking down on this incredible sight.
Noisily swooping, rising, falling.
Seem to be hearing a lot of chatter out there. A lot of gossip going on out there.
What we're seeing here is extraordinary.
Seeing these amazing birds with my own eyes makes me excited.
Closer and closer they come. Counting is becoming impossible. The task now is to identify colour bands so we know where they're from.
From New Zealand.
The godwits are now literally right on top of us.
I've seen identifiable birds and just the aerial display they put on for us. That's a rarity, just to be able to be so close to them. I rate this place a 10.
A 10?
A 10.
The Miranda team's expectations.
So many birds. Such a great place.
Have been blown out of the water.
Now they're all awake.
Whoa.
And they're all up.
Here they go.
Elephant Rock Bay's pristine natural habitat has been hidden from Western eyes for so long, but the world's about to find out.
How many foreigners have been to this place?
You are the very first one.
An unlikely collaboration between two very different countries, one open, one closed, is giving these threatened shorebirds a chance.
We see them fly back and pass by our land. I strongly feel that we must do more in our future to protect them.
Three scruffy Kiwis have gone where many diplomats would fear to tread. There may just be a lesson here for the rest of the world.
If you can sit down with each other and say we've both got differences, and all countries have got differences, so why can't we just find the common things that we can work towards? And in our case, it's conservation of migratory birds. And that's what we do.
Well, as a result of the Miranda team's work, North Korea has now signed up to two major international conventions on wetlands and shorebirds. And we'd like to thank the Asia New Zealand Foundation for their support of this trip to China and North Korea.